So, hello everybody. Today we are discussing the number one ladies detective agency. I think many of you may already be introduced to this series. For some of you, this must have been the first book that you read. And so the surprise today is that Mr. Shamil Rao will be joining me in the presentation. In fact, he has done the majority of the work this time in giving all the in helping me in preparing all the slides, and he's done all the hard work this time. and a huge thank you to him for joining in today and co-hosting this along with me. So welcome, Shamil Rao ji.
So I have to thank you, madam, actually. You joined us. This is the first time. I never do these things. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you. So let me share my screen and start the presentation. Okay, I hope it's clear for everybody. Is my floating video display distracting anyone from seeing the presentation? Is it blocking the view for anyone?
No, it isn't. It's fine.
Okay, great. Thank you so much. Okay, so today we're going to see a little bit about the author and about this particular series, the Ladies Detective Agency. And we are exploring a few of the topics in this particular series, and we'll finish with a few quotes. And we've also included a couple of questions in between, which we can pause at those particular slides and discuss about it. So Alexander Michael Smith is a British writer. He's actually a Britisher. He was but raised in Zimbabwe. And he has a very huge and a very close bond to Botswana, which is why he had written a lot about it. So Michael Smith's generous writing and dry humor, his gentleness and humanity, and his ability to evoke a place and a set of characters without caricature or condescension have endeared his books to readers, says the New York Times. He actually worked as a professor of medical law, and he continued working for a very long time. In fact, he continued working till the Ladies Detective Agency series became a hit. He has written more than 100 books. His books have been translated to more than 46 languages, and they are bestsellers throughout the world. He's also won numerous awards, including a very another prestigious literary award in Botswana itself. He started writing at the age of 8, and he writes almost 1,000 words an hour. He rarely rewrites his stories, except when he makes an occasional adjustment. In fact, he expressed his reluctance to relocate a particular scene once he had written it. This particular series, the number one ladies detective agency, brought him global fame and popularity. I would just like to include that since many of us were new to it, we started off with the first book. The first book moves slightly slowly, and because I think he wanted to set the base, the characters, give a bit of their history and other things. So if this particular book interested you, you would love even more the books which follow in the series. Actually, those dive right into the story, and it's much more engaging. So Alexander Michael Smith also rewrote and modernized Jane Austen's novel Emma. He kept the feel of the book intact. Moby Dick is next in line to be modernized and rewritten by him. One interesting fact is that he visits Botswana at least once every year, and he loves traveling, so he has taken many trips around the world. So what's special about this particular series is that this is not the usual crime story, you know. Here is a character who has this inherent desire to do good, and the way she you know, handles the crimes, she doesn't really feel that everything you know, deserves a punishment. Most of the time, the way she solves the crime and resolves it makes everyone happy, even the person who is actually the criminal over there. And another beautiful thing about this book is that the crimes are very simple. You know, it's not always murders and blood and all the other things. Usually there's I don't think I've read any which has a dead body. I'm trying to recollect. No. So even in this, the you know, we have this feeling that, oh, maybe the child was dead, but then finally at the end of the day we find him alive and well. So also one other beautiful thing about the book has been the way the description has been done. You know, he literally brings Botswana in front of our eyes. At least we don't know if it's the real Botswana, but for me, Botswana means all those bushes and you know, this rickety white van and the red bush tea. So these are become part of Botswana to me. Maybe it's not the real Botswana, but that's the Botswana I have in my head. And I'm sure that's how it's been for all the readers who don't know Africa, but who know the Africa only from his books. So, yeah. And one more thing about this particular series is how the lead character, Precious, actually has this capacity to understand human nature. And the book also offers a peek into it, you know. And this particular quality of the series reminded me a lot about Miss Marple in Agatha Christie, where Miss Marple actually also solves crimes using her understanding of human nature. However, the crimes there are more serious and the characters are totally different person. But yeah, only that one aspect of it reminds me always of Miss Marple. And so let's have a question, and I would love to know all of your point of view too. So by what means does Alexander Michael Smith sustain the reader's interest in the absence of the kind of, you know, tension, violence and suspense that drive most other mysteries? I'll stop the screen share and, you know, maybe we can discuss about it. Shamil Rao ji, would you like to include anything to this?
Okay, for the question you made, madam, actually.
For the question or in regarding any of these slides?
The slides, okay, because almost I think actually you have spoken about the author and his capacity to write 1,000 words. And it's okay, actually. But I would like to speak of the question that you raised, actually. Normally, as we understand, actually, in case of a thriller or a detective story, there is a lot of violence, death, and all those things, actually.
True.
In this case, actually, as you just said, actually, neither there is violence nor death or any tension type of a thing. It goes in a very smooth way, almost like a normal fiction type of a novel it goes. But the question comes actually how the writer could or Smith could sustain a reader's interest.
Right.
Then particularly he says it's a detective story and there is not much of a violence or death, dead bodies, anything like that. So what I feel is actually more than that, there are cases, there is no doubt about it, where actually one has to invest his common sense or whatever that is to find out. Let us take the first case itself. Someone comes and as an imposter and takes the role of a father and And how nicely she sorts it out and finds out actually the case.
Mm-hmm.
There is a lot of common sense involved. Similarly, and then what I feel is more than this investigation, there is the way she goes about solving a complaint, because her intention is actually she wants to help people solving their problems in their life. And she also says somewhere, we are not here to solve any crime here. We want to help people like that. Mm-hmm. That is very reflective in the sense. That is one thing.
True.
Interacting, I find actually she sometimes brings out the deep and dark human truths. Well, they are very much common actually. For instance, if you understand that one four-wheeler actually gets stolen away by one person, but wife says nothing doing, I want to hand it over. So somehow she comes to the day and she says, you find out the actual owner of this vehicle, my husband has stolen the four-wheeler, I want to hand it over. In another case, that Indian Patel story actually, the relation actually, the father is worried why whether the girl is in love with another boy or not. So they are all common issues actually, and she comes up in a flying colors in sorting them out. And while doing that, actually one can hardly miss her human touch and her common sense, human touch and penetrating eye for detail. That is what I feel actually made the stories rather attractive. You take any of these five or four, six stories actually. Only one story that I got last was actually regarding the missing boy. Abruptly, actually, it gets end in the middle. We don't know what happened. And we find its solution at the end. Last, only we come out of it. So there is an element of success, the technique employed, human values have been highlighted. So all these things, in absence of this violence, conventional detective story, violence, field, and other things, that is how author could sustain a reader's interest. That is what I felt. Because this is the first book I have read. Not only that, I have come across this author for the first time because of your introduction. If that is the case, I would have missed him. So these are my opinions. Thank you.
It's also true that usually for any detective, for that matter, any detective agency placed anywhere in the world, I think they get all types of crimes, but what we end up reading in the books are only the murders and all these high flying things, but usually they get all these small things also, and the smaller the town, I think the crime is also smaller, and little things of, my hen is missing, or my boy is missing, or who is this man? She's having the doubt about the man who's come and sitting there and who's calling himself as her father. And usually detective novels don't talk about that.
If you look at it, madam, there is no blood anywhere.
Yeah, true.
There is no blood. Even there is no gunshot also, excepting one.
With the crocodile.
The crocodile, yeah.
Except that nowhere in the whole of the 200 or 250 pages, no gunshot anywhere.
True.
That's why I feel no blood, no gunshots. So it is something different. That is why actually Max Classmith could be successful in sustaining one's attention.
Also, I felt there was much more than the story. The plots are not the only hero of the book. There's the setting, which I really liked reading about Africa and Botswana, how her father goes to the diet. There's so many other things also to like, other than just the cases. She herself is such an interesting personality. Yes. And then there's so much happening. So it's not, you're not reading it like an Agatha Christie book to know what happened. That's just one thing that you like about the book. There are so many other things that keep you busy and happy reading it. So much more to it. So I think that's how it must have been very quaint at that point of time when the books came out. I don't think there were too many authors writing about Africa and little things, like she's so proud to be from Botswana. For me, that was a novelty. Like, you don't associate pride of the land with Africa, although you should. It is so great, has so many things to offer. But all that was very novel, and that made it very interesting. Other than just the plots, of course, the cases were nice in themselves. And I've read 2-3 books, so I might be mixing them up a little bit. But it's interesting. Other than just the cases, it has much more to offer, the books.
True. Actually, I think once we finish reading the book, and in fact, if we read 3-4 books in the series, after that, I think we don't remember about the particular cases.
Exactly. Which cases in which book.
Yeah. And I think that's interesting also, because even when you reread it, you never feel anything, because you don't remember exactly what happened in that particular case or how did she, solve it.
Yeah.
And one more thing, which I think was the only negative review about the about this book, is what we were just talking about. So many people who support, PETA and other things were very disturbed by that she killed 2 animals in the book. A snake and a crocodile. So whichever negative review which I saw mentioned that one point only. This was so unnecessary. Why did she have to kill 2 animals? And that's all.
Yeah. You will always end up annoying somebody or the other, whatever you write. So.
Yeah. But it was, it's good. It is really good. So I'll go back. Yeah, please. Yes, sir. Please tell me.
The description of nature is also good, madam, actually.
Yeah, very good, actually.
Beautiful. Different paragraphs, actually. Really, as you said, just said, you felt Botswana. I also felt it, particularly when I read that paragraph. She makes a round. I hardly remember that, actually. In a traffic, she goes early morning. She narrates beautifully, actually. I felt I was a morning walk, actually. I was in a morning walk. That good it was. I liked that, actually.
Yeah. You realize that a desert can also be so beautiful. Like how she says there are trees and there's the desert behind that.
Exactly. Exactly.
Yeah, the stark beauty of it. Absolutely right.
Yes.
So Shanti says it's a feel-good book, which we rightly deserve in this pandemic situation. Mrs. Ramotswe is a warm-hearted, old-fashioned, and she has lots of common sense. It's a light reading, which is apt for the present day. It has an old-world charm. Yeah, that's true, you know. So there's no cell phones and no Facebook in the book. Yeah.
Hello, this is Saran. Yeah, so I agree with all of you, actually. Yeah, it was quite different. I read it about 10 years back and have read around 3-4 books in the series. The most important thing I felt is, you are able to relate to a place and the people who are quite unlike you. You know, so the human nature is something which is a common thread across people in different places and different times. And I think he made us able to relate to the people in a very different setting. So that is one. And the magic of Botswana, certainly he has brought out. Soon after we first read this book, we had an occasion to, in an obscure shop, we found some red tea, which was sourced from Africa. So we were so interested and, just took that. But after that, that shop also did not have stock. So that was just a one-off thing that we indulged in. And somehow I feel this book resembles something like, R.K. Narayan's books. No big events happening, nothing great happening.
Yeah, right.
But, the everyday life depiction itself is so good, so immersive. That you completely relish it.
I endorse your point, sir. Sir, I endorse your point. Because the other day I read English Teacher by R.K. Narayan. It's so heart-touching, so immersive reading, actually. Very simple story, nowhere not much of it is. Well, it's a very plain road, highway, driving like that. Smooth story, and it resembles to an extent. Of course, language is a little different. This is Indianized, and I find it is an anglicized type of writing, actually. But there are, I accept, actually, similarities between Nectaral Finch and our Narayan. Good. Wonderful.
Yeah. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Hey, Archana. This is Ranjini.
Hi, Ranjini.
Sorry, I joined a bit late. Maybe I missed your introduction of the book.
So, Ranjini, you heard it as an audiobook, right?
Yeah, so I just wanted to give my two cents because I borrowed the audiobooks from the Singapore Library, and it was not just audiobook. Normally, if you are familiar with audiobooks, you know, the author is narrating it or someone else is narrating the story. And even though they might have some accents and some emotions while reading it, this one was a dramatization. So it was actually like a play. So the male cat, there was a, you know, every character had a different voice. So there were these two ladies, you know, Mrs. Ramotswe and Mama Kutsi, they had different people had the accent. The men were different, and there would be this background noises, someone knocking on the door, or, you know, rain is falling or whatever. It was so good. And because audio narration feels so close to you, right? Because it's inside your ear. And then the visualization is even more easy because they got the African English, right? The accent, how they say the words. And then it became a bit more, like, for example, I found it very funny. They would say things like, my father is late and my mother is also late. And, you know, like they refer to their deceased parents. And I was like,
oh, okay.
So many times it's like, is he also late? I'm like, is he late for what? So, I mean, obviously, I know the usage late, but it was also that British English spoken by the Africans. The only thing I didn't get, and I didn't take the trouble to find out, maybe you can help me, is what period, what years are reflected? You know, this is Botswana of when? Is it like late 90s? Is it mid last century? Because it seems such a gentle place, and it seems such a... Like R.K. Narayan types, right? Who lived 100 years ago. So I didn't know, but I think Alexander McCall Smith is not, I mean, I think it's later part of last century, probably. I don't know.
In fact, the latest book in the series just came out in 2015, I guess. So the book is still going on. The series is still on, you know.
But, you know, because she keeps referring to the old Botswana, you know, in old Botswana, people would do this. I'm not so sure. So, again, I was wondering what generation are we looking at? And if Botswana is really like this, you know, gentle and calm, even, let's say, 20 years ago, I'm like, that's a great achievement.
But two things which I was just reminded by one of the interviews which I was reading. So one is about the real Botswana. So where he says that he's often asked, you know, is this the real Botswana? Is this how Africa is? So he says, this is a completely realistic view of Botswana, but it's only one of the views. So Botswana is like any other country. It has its own troubles. There are problems. There are other things happening, but I don't want to show all that. So that's what he says.
Yeah, I agree. I was in Tanzania 2 years ago, and that, I mean, of course, that is East Africa. But I also felt that Africa, because it hasn't been as industrialized as the other continents, there is a different rhythm to their life. It's not like they don't have roads and they don't have cars, or they don't have, you know, women were working everywhere, even if they had the headscarf. But there was a little more gentleness. Even as a tourist, of course, I'm speaking as a tourist, I never felt unsafe. I went alone for a few days. My daughters and I were alone before we joined my husband. He had gone to climb Kilimanjaro. So we were alone by ourselves, but I never felt afraid. You know, I organized with a tour guide. I said, you know, I arranged for transport to take us, whatever. I didn't feel like Tanzania, I believe, is nice. Kenya probably is more. People tell me that Kenya, you have to be very careful and stuff like that. But Botswana reminded me of Tanzania, and I'm like, okay, this is like this. It's not a bad way to be, right? But like you said, it may not be the only view. It's like tourists who go to India and say, oh, India is so beautiful, India is so great, and everything. India is so dangerous, India is so dirty, or whatever, right? And then you realize that everyone sees what they want to see and takes what they need from that place. But it was a very nice read, and I read it because of you. So thank you.
I reread the book because of all of you. So thank you, in fact. One more point which I wanted to add to what Sarath had mentioned about human nature being, you know, universal. So... another question which often, you know, is posed to Alexander McCall Smith is that you are a white writer you know, white male writer writing about a black African woman, and you're a Britisher and you're writing about an African culture. So don't you feel that this is an appropriation of some sort, you know? And he always says that it's definitely, you know, not. It's definitely not an appropriation, because what I am writing about is human nature. And that is universal. Just because a person is not from a particular place, there's no reason why he should not write about that particular place. If he is able to impress a view of that place in another's mind, then it's fine. And also, he was brought up in Zimbabwe, and he visits Botswana at least once a year. So he feels he, you know, the picture he shows of Botswana, it's not really about Botswana, right? Finally, at the end of the day, it's about human nature. So he says, I have all the right to write these books. And yeah, so that's, I think, perfectly right what he says.
I think, but the appropriation part has become very big, especially in the US publication world, you know. So if you're not Hispanic, then you cannot write a story about, you know, Mexicans. If you're not black, then, you know, you cannot write a story because you've not lived that experience. And so while they agree that you can write any story as a fiction writer, you can set your story anywhere, but they always say that do the work, you know, do the research required, you know, would they use these kind of words? Would this, you know, home situation exist in that country? But I think then the explanation for that is it is one view, right? The minute you say it is one of many views, then everyone has a right to say that. But for us, like, think about us. We don't know Botswana, and we read this right. book. And in our mind, Botswana is the Botswana of this book. Mm-hmm. Now, it is our fault if we think that that represents its history and geography and everything. We also have to take, like, for example, I found it very funny. They have this character, the male detective agency, you know, the satisfaction guaranteed detective agency. And that guy has New York written on it. And I thought this is such a human nature thing, right? Even in India, we'll find people who will, like, do a big job of, like, you know, some degree they had or some place they visited, that photo will be there in their office just to, like, impress the people. So I thought it was so true, that human nature of showing off. It was nicely done.
Right. What do you I just have a point of view which struck me just now. What do you think of that, Ranjini? I have this feeling that when you're highlighting some issues in a particular country or in a particular culture or some problems faced by that particular culture or those people, then appropriation becomes an issue. But when things are shown in a rosy manner, maybe it's not that big an issue. I don't know.
Yeah, I agree, because I think same thing, right? Like, 30 years ago, when I was a student in the US, people would ask me, oh, how come you speak good English? Or everyone thought, you know, Mother Teresa's Calcutta is the view of whole of India is like that, you know, like the City of Joy movie, which had come at that time. And so people didn't know about the country. So you became a representative of the country. And if you were conflicting with their view of the country, they were confused, like, we think India is a poor, uneducated, third world country, and then here you come and you join you know, a PhD program, and you're speaking English and you're able to hold conversations, then suddenly they are confused. So but then when they ask you that, oh, do you ride an elephant to school or something like that, right? So again, it's a limited view. So where did they get that view? They read somewhere or they saw somewhere and they get it. So it is one view, but it's not the complete story. And I think that is why it's important for all of us that we also should get a complete picture. Fiction doesn't propose to be a, you know, it's not a documentary, right? That's so true. So we have to keep that in mind. But hey, we can always enjoy a good book, right?
That's true.
No
true,
need
definitely.
To make it so serious. So.
There's a very interesting TED talk by Chimamanda Adichie on the dangers of a single story. Must look that up. She is so articulate, and she says the same thing. She says, when I write in English, then people are like, oh my god, Nigeria, Africa, how you write? That's so very nice. She speaks really well, and this is exactly what she says, that you must, there should be lots of stories, and they should be read by lots of people, so that they have a wider view of a place. I mean, a place is not just one thing. There are many things, many shades to a place. So that's a very interesting TED talk. I've watched it multiple times. It's so interesting. She speaks well.
Yes, yeah, yes, Tulika, I've watched it too.
Yeah, I've watched it. In fact, side by side with this book, I've been reading Chimamanda's Americana. And I'm doing the same thing. I'm listening to the audio version. And I have the print book also with me. So again, you know, I really like when the accent is very true to that. So the Nigerian English is British English, but they have their own accent. So it's only one narrator who narrates everything, but still it feels very true, right? So there is a little more authenticity that comes with the accent. But yeah, I think we all have to be aware that a single story is not the whole story.
Right. So Sarath has just mentioned in the comments that the recent book was in fact released in 2020. Sorry, it was my mistake. It's the 21st book in the series. So that's great.
So much reading to be done.
Whenever you need a light read, just pick up the next volume.
yes, definitely.
In fact, she does mention at one place that it's a few years after the independence. The book is set. So I think Botswana independence is around late 90s only. So which is why 1998, it's set somewhere. Okay. 96, I think, got independence.
Oh, that's great. Thanks.
Yeah,
So let me share the screen and we'll continue with it. Shamil Rauji, do you want to take up the discussion topics?
Just a second. Okay.
Yes. Hey, I'm sorry. This is. I changed it from the. Sorry. I have my mistake. Please ignore the. I think this is from Wuthering Heights, which I edited it. So I guess that's why this was the discussion on Heathcliff. Okay, please continue.
Actually, the aspect of guilt, actually, which she has written, it was curious how some people had a highly developed sense of guilt, she thought, while others had none. Some people would agonize over minor slips or mistakes on their part, while others would feel quite unmoved by their own gross acts of betrayal or dishonesty. I liked the way actually she has categorized the sense of guilt in human beings. And the categorization, what I feel is must have happened basing on her professional as well as personal experience. If you look at it actually, when she referred highly developed sense of guilt, I feel actually she is referring to one of the clients actually, that is a lady client, whose husband has stolen a car actually. And she wanted the car to be handed over to the right owner. So for a small thing, for a mistake not committed, a crime not committed by her, she's so sensitive and comes to this, our precious, asking her to find out actually the right owner, and I wish the car is handed over, stolen by my husband. That is first aspect. And second one, actually, she must be referring to that note. For instance, despite so many other things also, that person, he feels quite unmoved by their own gross acts of betrayal or dishonesty. And she must be referring to her ex-husband, actually, note Makoti. Who had an ex-husband and a child, a small-born child. So this guilt actually, when she speaks of a two levels, one is both extreme ends. One portion of a client who's extremely sensitive to guilt. Another one,
your voice is slightly breaking. We missed the last sentence which you spoke.
Achai, the internet is unstable here. Power shortage. There was a rain here, so that is the problem.
Okay. Maybe if you sometimes turning off the camera helps.
Could be a reason. What suggested was the guilt that no problem. The guilt actually she has earmarked the two extremes. So that is it. And the other one, her own ex-husband, actually. So one who feels extremely about a guilt that he has not committed a crime, one who is extremely insensitive for the crime he has committed. These are the two extremes that she has dealt with in this court, like the Tehsil Naidu. We also comment on this. Thank you.
So I think whatever I had planned for Botswana topic, we had spoken a lot about it already. So one of the, I think, highlights of the entire book is the love which Precious has for her motherland. So she says, "I am not ashamed to be called an African patriot. I love all the people whom God made, but I especially know how to love the people who live in this place. They are my people, my brothers and sisters. It is my duty to help them to solve the mysteries in their lives. That is what I am called to do." It's actually quite refreshing to see this kind of patriotism. And also, she doesn't hide it. She's very open about it and she's proud about showing it off. "The only thing that makes me sad is that I shall be leaving Africa when I die. I love Africa, which is my mother and my father. When I am dead, I shall miss the smell of Africa, because they say that where you go, wherever that may be, there is no smell and no taste." Another point which I wanted to talk to you about in this book has been about feminism. In fact, the New York Times categorizes the book as a feminist comedy. And I think there's a lot of progressive thinking which is exhibited by Precious. Also, most of the women characters are strong. They are strong women. Maybe the woman who doesn't mourn for her dead husband, or the, you know, even the secretary who joins Precious, or even the lady whose husband steals the car. You know, she's so strong, and she feels that it's justified to give back the car. You know, they are strong and very sensible women characters. So in this background, there is Note Mukoti, who is the sinister background presence of Precious's life. And so New York Times says that these books have, the entire series has an undernote of a lot of serious topics which are discussed in a very light manner. So it says that this it calls Precious as this benign instrument of justice, you know, and she has a very kind-hearted way of exacting retribution too. In fact, even in this particular book, police is mentioned, but not in a very positive way everywhere, you know. As far as possible, they don't want to involve the police at all. They just want to solve it and finish it up without it. Which is also interesting. And it made me wonder if that could be something which maybe the author wanted to be true to Africa. And though he doesn't, harp on it, maybe he has shown a slight view about the African police here, could be. And okay. The other thing in this book is about women in politics. Mr. Shamil Rao will be talking more about this now. So Dr. Makitsi says in a particular place that we need more women in public life. They are very practical people, women, unlike us men. Mama Ramotse was quick to agree. If more women were in power, they wouldn't let wars break out, she said. Women can't be bothered with all this fighting. We see war for what it is, a matter of broken bodies and crying mothers. Would you like to add to that, Shamil Raoji?
Yes, actually. This, when we speak of feminism and the strength of women and their maternal, what they call feelings, this quote is quite valid in this sense. If we can link it, because particularly the last two lines are very much touched with that, where it says actually, we see war for what it is, a matter of broken bodies and crying mothers. It's a very sensitive expression, sensitive. So for instance, why I was feeling was, as far as the recent pandemic is concerned, the countries that were headed by women leaders fared far, far better. For example, say New Zealand, Germany, Finland, Iceland, Denmark, Norway, Taiwan. As far as mitigating the hardship is concerned and reducing the number of deaths is concerned, they fared better than compared to those countries where actually the leadership was in male hands. And I read actually an internet head, I read in a book. They said actually the particular aspect of empathy that a woman has helped it. So the question of a female leadership style was more effective than the traditionally autocratic male style. That's what they said. And when crisis has hit, particularly in the form of a pandemic, actually, it was observed, the preference was for command and control in its place, actually. It is a relational leadership that what mattered. Particularly more than the leadership, the traits of motherhood, say these women leaders like empathy, concern, inclusiveness, safety, and aversion to take risk, actually, that must have played an important role. Of course, there is another line in this book, actually, Indian reference for that matter. Dr. Mukherjee refers to Mrs. Gandhi and Mrs. Golda Meir also. And he says, actually, who also had a war. This is open to discussion, but I still limit myself to the first portion, that is actually the empathy, the nature of motherhood in women that helped, actually. Thank you, ma'am.
True, that is very true. I find myself agreeing with you, but of course there are women leaders who start conflict, and of course it's a matter for debate. But I think one of the things what you mentioned makes a lot of meaning, especially for this pandemic. We want a leader who relates to the people. We want a leader who sympathizes with the people, empathizes with us, who understands and understands what people are going through. And I think maybe as you said, maybe those countries which had women leaders, I'm not sure, maybe that's how they fared better, I don't know. So continuing with this, so there's a question here. So how does the author integrate the idea of feminism and chauvinism in the narrative? I'll stop the screen share and maybe we can have a small discussion before we see the quotes and finish the presentation. Okay, so there's a comment from Shanti. She is warm-hearted, bringing back the teacher's son back home. Yes, we feel happy when the boy meets his father. Really a warm person. Yes, true. I think there was no other way of making us feel good in the book. Even if she had solved the crime, even if something had happened to the boy and she had solved the crime, we wouldn't have felt as peaceful as what we felt in what in her bringing the child back. So it really ended on a very good note, and you know, it's stayed true to the genre. It's a real feel good book. So what do you think, Tulika? So what do you think about the feministic aspects over there and chauvinism also over there? In some places, you know, there's an extreme patriotism shown. Some places there's this huge rift between, you know, between the men and women in the African society, which is shown. So there's, I think, one of the places the character who doubts whether the person who in her house is her father or not. So she mentions that he just sits and, you know, keeps asking me to do things for him. And in response, Mama Ramotse says, most men are like that, right? So there's a lot of, I think, a lot of boxing of the characters happening. Maybe that's true with the culture. So what's your view?
The culture one, and of course we have to see it in the context of the times. I'm not justifying it, and I just don't like it. But again, the cultural influence, and it's a very simple book. So you don't, it doesn't mean for you to look for so much subtext. It's not right, yes, but seen in the context of the times, I think, I mean, you read it and you go ahead with it. There is chauvinism, definitely. And because the daughter is happy to do all of that.
Right.
If he's my father, I'm happy to do all that. But the fact that he's pretending, that is what is troubling her. So,
correct.
Yeah, I'll go with that.
I have an opinion. I found, maybe I didn't read as deeply because I was listening to the book, but I felt in many ways author was politically correct, as in when it says number one ladies detective agency for ladies and others. So pretty much it included everyone, but behind the ladies, right? So it's like that then how she refers to herself as a traditionally built woman, right? So she doesn't use like words like fat, you know, which may be offensive today. Everyone is very sensitive and like, oh, fat shaming and stuff like that. So the synonyms that have been used. And also I think even where the difference between the genders is made clear, like at least in the version that I heard, her fiance is depressed and he refuses to take medication and she sends him over, I don't know if it's there in the book, but then she says he's behaving like a stubborn boy, and you know, stubborn boys need to be dealt with a firm hand. And that matron says that, oh, nowadays everyone just wants to be very nice, no one wants to say things as they are. I think the doctor says that, you know, like basically everyone wants to be politically correct, like even if it's for their own good, you don't want to hurt them. So you let them suffer indirectly. And I thought that, wow, you know, this, they really have, at least authors very carefully chosen the words that even 20 years later, like when you take it out of context, like today, if you go and read many of the old books, we'll say, oh, it's racist or sexist or whatever, right? But it was written for those times. But this book seems to have sidestepped a lot of these landmines, which currently would raise flags. And you're saying that, oh, but it's worded so delicately and so aptly also. So I must credit the author for picking words that will stand the test of time, I think, which is quite a difficult thing to do these days.
True.
Yeah, that's really pertinent. Actually, that's a very smart way to write a book. So I agree wholeheartedly. Also about her personal appearance, because she takes such pride in it. I think in the between the first and the fourth, fifth book, there are 3-4 people who are proposing to her. And she's so... some men like their women like this. I found that so sweet. So nicely written. It's great true. For somebody's self-esteem. She has, it's good.
Yeah. She makes a good role model for people.
Absolutely.
Super sensitive.
Yeah, right. She's so happy with the way she looks. And it shows, I think, ultimately it's the confidence and your self-esteem which comes through, and which is what people appreciate or like in you. So I think it's very well written.
There is one place in which I think these two are going somewhere she and her assistant, and then she says that nowadays, you know, everyone wants to be thin like those girls are. But you know, it's not so good to be so thin, because if you're walking in the jungle and you don't even make any noise, the snakes will not know. I think it's such a funny way of saying it, because of my weight. So cute.
Yeah, right.
But Ranjini, I think you have a few scenes and dialogues which we have not had in the book.
I highly recommend the audio, because it's like short, it's about 1 hour. You know, so it's very nice. You can just listen to it on your walk and smile to yourself. I'm sure people saw me laughing and thinking that this woman, I don't know, she's not even talking, she just seems to be smiling at something. It was really nice, relaxing.
Great. So let me you know, get back to the screen. Yeah, so I had a few quotes. I had some quotes. These are by Alexander McCall Smith in other books, not exactly in this one, but I just found them so interesting that, you know, I wanted to share them with you. So one of them goes like this. So if your ceiling should fall down, then you have lost a room, but gained a courtyard. Think of it that way. When you're with somebody you love, the smallest things can be so important, so amusing. Because love transforms the world, everything. So that the way that smallest things, you know, I also found it's a little bit, you know, I think similar to what we speak to as Indians. A life without stories would be no life at all. And stories bound us, did they not? One to another, the living to the dead, people to animals, people to the land. These are quotes from the book, and they've been chosen by Mr. Shamal Rao. Every man has a map in his heart of his own country, and that the heart will never allow you to forget this map. Eyes were very important. The eyes allowed you to see right into a person, to penetrate the very essence, and that was why people with something to hide wore sunglasses indoors. Made me think of the film actors and actresses of our Bollywood. You can go through life and make new friends every year, every month practically. But there was never any substitute for those friendships of childhood that survive into adult years. Those are the ones in which we are bound to one another with hoops of steel. Hunches are another form of knowledge. And yeah, so these are some of the places from which I read. So Alexander McCall Smith has a very nice website to check it out. Let me... I'm very poor in this. I don't know how to stop the screen share now. Just give me a minute. Yes. Okay. Yes. I have a few messages on chat. Yeah. Like our politicians always with sunglasses. Yes, especially I'm remembering a person from my hometown. So please feel free to share anything else, any other quotes or any other things that you would like to discuss. You want to add anything to this, Mr. Shamal Rao?
The last question, actually, that I think we should get somewhere there.
Yes.
How does the author integrate, actually? The question was how to integrate. The author integrated the idea of feminism on one side and chauvinism into the narrative. So if you have to take feminism, who represented feminism? Which character for that matter? And as for chauvinism, which character of the book has represented chauvinism? And how integration happened? That was the question. So if you ask me, ma'am, actually, feminism, we can take our precious Ramos Mama, it's okay, she represented that. And then the other side, actually, don't Mukoti represent that male chauvinism, because he went on dominating her, creating problems to her and other things. So when you have both the roles actually judiciously represented, and they are integrated into the story, I feel actually the concept of the idea of feminism and chauvinism got represented through these two characters. Other than these two, I'm not able to locate any other character or characters actually whose integration has helped in giving the idea of feminism and chauvinism. That's what I got. I'm not finding any other character actually.
I felt even with Precious herself, you know, at many places she accepts, you know, that this is how men are. So this is how the situation would be. So this is what is expected. So don't you feel that in some ways even she contributes to it also, you know?
Okay. Right, actually.
She accepts it at least. I wouldn't say she contributes to it. I would say she accepts it and she tries to find a way to stand up against it.
That I will accept. And he finds an escape route. That is also there, actually. She comes, actually, and survives and comes into normalcy. That is important, actually. When she outright rejects, actually, she builds up her life again. That we have to appreciate.
Correct.
Because it's a child that is lost, a husband that mistreated her, misbehaved with her, almost ending, and there was nothing. And with father's money, she sets up a shop, becomes successful. I found her, actually, quite capable.
Correct.
She was a very strong lady, penetrating common sense, actually. She was very observant of human nature. I find, actually, even as a painter also, she has got the other quality. In the school days, she gets some recognized for that. So I find, actually, of all the characters, as far as this book is concerned, because I have not read the rest of the books, I have no idea. Mama Precious actually stands out as a wonderful feminist. And we have the other extreme who has cheated her, actually. And there are, in milder forms, there are other people also. But okay.
True. Shanti says she brought to my mind Uncle Tom's wife in Uncle Tom's Cabin. She's also a very matronly character. I don't remember very clearly, but I remember the character to some extent. The rich man is a chauvinist. He doubts her. The way he treats his wife is also a proof of male chauvinism. Right. I agree with that. Would anybody else like to add anything?
I would like to think that the real Botswana is like depicted in the book.
Yeah, even I would really want to think so. So a few years back, one of my friends whom I had lost touch with for many years, so she had come to Bombay. And so I asked her, so where were you all these years? And she told me we were living in Botswana. And I was so jealous. I don't know whether how was her experience there, but I was so jealous. My first impression was, wow. Yeah. Sulika, you want to add anything else?
No, I think we're done.
Yes.
Done.
So I've not put up any post for the next book to choose the next book. So I'll do so, immediately. Does anyone have any recommendations which you think it would be good to read in the current, you know, scenario, or something that you would think would be nice to discuss? please feel free to, you know, tell me now or maybe drop me a message too. It's fine. By tomorrow morning, I think I'll put up a post with